Okay, great. Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Talks in Chinese Humanities series. My name is Minerva Inwald. I'm Judith Nielsen, postdoctoral fellow in contemporary art at UNSW Sydney. And I'm also the seminars officer for the Australian Society of Asian Humanities. Before we start today, I'd just like to acknowledge that I'm on the land of the Wangal people and pay my respects to elders past, present, and future. So the Talks in Chinese Humanities series is co-presented by the China Studies Centre, the Department of Chinese Studies, both at the University of Sydney, as well as the Australian Society for Asian Humanities and the Faculty of Art, Design and Architecture at UNSW. I'm going to now pass over to my colleague Josh Stenberg from the Department of Chinese Studies at the University of Sydney to introduce our speaker for today and get us started. So thank you, Josh.
Thanks, Minerva. Thank all of you for joining us today. It's a wonderful opportunity to get to learn more about our colleague's work in the University of Queensland. Dr. Will Gather is a lecturer in Chinese at the University of Queensland and a practicing Chinese English translator. Having completed his BA honors from the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, Will worked in Beijing at the British Embassy and then subsequently completed his PhD at the University of Queensland. Will currently conducts research on Chinese literary studies with a particular focus on the quote unquote post-postmodern within a Chinese context. And we're particularly excited today because this is, I think, mostly going to be about Will's new book. Exciting for all of those interested, all of those of us who are interested in contemporary Chinese literature and working, especially for those of us working in Australia, I think it's important to hear what the new research looks like. And so without further ado, I'll pass on to Will. We'll have about 45 minutes, give or take, for Will to speak, and then I think he's happy to answer questions at the end of the hour.
Yeah, cool, excellent. So should I, I'll start sharing my screen. So if you can't see it, just let me know. 1 second. Okay, is that all good? Is that, can everybody see that?
Yeah, that looks good.
Cool, excellent, great. Well, thank you very much, everyone. It's wonderful to be able to talk to you today and to talk about my book. So actually, Josh has introduced me, so I won't bother introducing myself again. What I'll do is I'll go straight into talking about the three main aspects that I'll be addressing in today's talk from my book. So first of all, so the title of my book is Ma Yuan, the Chinese Avant-Garde, Metafiction and Post-postmodernism. Now, there are three main aspects that my book addresses. So number one, it is an author study. So I think this is in itself fairly significant. I'm sure those of you who are work within contemporary Chinese literature probably are very aware of the fact that Chinese literature, contemporary Chinese literature, has certainly in the last 20, 30 years been very heavily influenced by cultural studies approaches. So it's invariably the case that author studies, dedicated author studies, have been somewhat marginalized. Now, I think there's a real need to redress that balance, because the cultural studies approach to literature has obvious flaws, and it leaves a lot of gaps in terms of how we understand individual Chinese authors. So number one, it is an author study, which isn't necessarily the most fashionable thing to do, but I think it's arguably quite a necessary thing to do at the moment. There are two main things that I do on top of providing an author study. The first one is that I attempt to reappraise the Chinese avant-garde movement and Chinese postmodernism. And then I also offer an investigation into the Chinese post-postmodern condition. So first of all, let me just introduce the author Ma Yuan, who I have based my book on. So he was born in Liaoning province in 1953. And like many authors of his generation, he was one of the rusticated youth sent down into the countryside to work on farms in usually remote areas of China. One of the key aspects in his life, and what I argue is one of the key aspects in his literary development, is the fact that he moved to Tibet in 1982. Now, this would have a huge impact on the author personally, but also more interestingly, perhaps from my perspective, in terms of his literary style. Now, Ma Yuan is famous for being one of the key authors of the avant-garde movement of the mid to late 1980s. So this was a period of, under Deng Xiaoping, of significant economic and cultural liberalization. Within China, Ma Yuan is essentially most famous for being one of the instigators, one of the most crucial early figures within this particular literary movement, which is known for its experimental, iconoclastic, and challenging nature. After engaging on a period of literary output within the avant-garde period, he then seemingly withdrew from literary practice entirely, after which he then became a professor of literature in Shanghai. Then subsequently he moved to Hainan province, and then he currently lives in Nanluoshan in Qixiongbanna. And I'll talk about that in detail later, because that's quite a significant part within his development as an author. So Ma Yuan is largely still famous for a handful of novels written during the mid-1980s within this very specific cultural movement, the avant-garde movement. These three novels in particular are arguably still the author's most famous works. Xugo, Ganlisu de Youhuo, and Lasa He Nisha. These three works in particular are still considered his representative texts. And even though he is still currently writing, it is invariably these works that the author gets judged according to. So one of the most significant aspects of this author is that he had a very specific role within a very time-limited wider cultural movement. Now, within his most famous work, which is arguably this one here, Xugo, the first line of this novella is still arguably his most famous individual sentence that he's ever written. So instantly we understand how this author changed the various different dynamics about literary practice within China. So purely by stating, I am that Chinese guy called Ma Yuan, I write novels, you are instantly breaking a huge number of literary conventions. So this is probably the most famous thing that he has ever written. And still to this day, this is often quoted in relation to his works. The fact that at the start of one of his novels, he broke all literary convention. He stated in an overtly fictional way, my name is Ma Yuan and I write novels. I am writing a novel. So fundamentally, Ma Yuan is known for a relatively specific set of narrative devices, which within this particular cultural movement functioned as evidence of a certain form of literary experimentation. So number one, critics often said that Ma Yuan entered into his own texts. So they would often have narrators that are called Ma Yuan and somehow include autobiographically verifiable information about the real person called Ma Yuan. There would also be multiple different authors in the text. So one of Ma Yuan's texts can have three or four different authors, all of them arguing with each other about what the real text actually is. In addition, the reader starts to actually peer within his work. So there will be moments in which an author figure is having a discussion with the reader about the text. Now, even though these are relatively simple devices in narratological terms, they're not particularly massive structural changes. And yet, within this particular cultural period, these set of devices essentially defined how Chinese literary criticism understood this author. Fundamentally, he was understood through these specific devices, metafictional devices. Other examples being when characters argue back with the narrator, which is often happens within his works. The narrative levels, for example, in which you have an author or a narrator on one level, narrating a text from the past on a level below. In many of his works, the level below will somehow encroach upon the level above and destabilize the whole architecture of the narrative. Finally, the author widely employed intertextuality, which is one of the hallmarks of metafictional texts. So essentially, within this particular very sort of time-limited period within the 1980s, there were a range of metafictional devices which then typified how critics understood the author. The final key thing to mention is that many of these works, not all of them, but many of them were set in Tibet. Now that is another crucial aspect of how the author was appraised. So in terms of critical responses, overwhelmingly, the author is seen as a formalist who was experimenting with narrative. Overwhelmingly, critics saw value in Ma Yuan purely as an author who would change the boundaries of the generic boundaries of fiction. Now, some critics found great value in that. Some of them thought that this overt fictionality and having the author enter into his own text was a huge insult to the sanctity of the narrative process. And specifically what that meant was the role of fiction up until that point had largely been typified by instrumentalism, whereby somehow literature can be used to instruct, to inform, or to create dialogues about specific social issues. Now, when a narrator enters into his text and starts to say about how it's all fiction and how when characters argue back with the author, the literary instrumentalism function then becomes completely corrupted. And many critics, certainly within the 1980s and 1990s, felt that Ma Yuan's work was a complete disregard for the responsibility of literary practice. So there was a very strong mix between those that thought that these experiments were somehow worthwhile and those that thought that they were essentially a sign that literature had completely exhausted its own social responsibility. By far the most influential critic on Ma Yuan was Wu Liang, a very influential Chinese literary critic who came up with this idea of the narrative trap. Now, Wu Liang was not necessarily overtly critical of Ma Yuan in the same way that other critics definitely were. Yet he argues that fundamentally, Ma Yuan's narratives are traps. What he means by that is that if you try to engage with them sincerely, if you try to read them along metaphorical and allegorical lines, ultimately you'll be trapped. And ultimately the reader should not be naive enough to read this kind of literature as if it's real literature. Now, in this period, in the 1980s and 90s, all of these critical reactions to what essentially are a relatively sort of standard set of metafictional devices, the reactions were incredibly illuminating. Okay, for example, Wu Liang stated that, "I assert that Ma Yuan did not write The Allure of the Ganges Mountains," which is one of his most famous novels. "He did not write it in a conscious manner. So even if people find profound meanings in this text, Ma Yuan would not have been aware of any single one of these." Now that's quite a staggering thing to say, to say that a writer was writing unconsciously, and that even if there is meaning to be found, then the author did not intend that meaning. I mean, it's a staggering leap of logic to even start arguing about what the intention of the author is on that level. but then to state that there's no way the author means for there to be anything meaningful behind this is also incredibly illuminating about the state of literary criticism within China in the 1980s. This quote also is by Wang Ning, who is possibly one of the most important critics on Chinese postmodernism, essentially saying the same thing. According to Wang Ning, who was very highly praised Ma Yuan very greatly, who in his eyes were serious experiments with literary discourse. However, according to Wang Ning, Ma Yuan's novels were nothing but a typical text for deconstructive anatomy interpretation. So fundamentally, the critical responses to Ma Yuan, and specifically the responses to a range of metafictional devices, were incredibly illuminating. Overwhelmingly, critics were of the conclusion that they were interesting experiments that somehow pushed back the boundaries of generic conventions, but that ultimately they were meaningless. Now, within the last 20 years, there have been many excellent studies on the avant-garde movement, on Chinese postmodernism, on the literature of the 1980s, which takes a different approach and reappraises the role that these works had. These are three good examples of recent reappraisals of the Chinese avant-garde. I would highly recommend Lin Qingxin's work, Brushing History Against the Grain. It's possibly one of the best works on Chinese contemporary literature that I've read. This work is, however, specifically devoted to historical fiction. So in particular, Ma Yuan and Yu Hua. The second one here by Chen Jianguo, The Aesthetics of the Beyond, does mention Ma Yuan as being an important figure, but not one of these works actually addresses Ma Yuan's novels. But I think even more critically, even though they make excellent progress in reappraising the lasting value of the Chinese avant-garde, they do not concentrate on the role of self-reflexivity and metafiction within the avant-garde movement. Now this, as we've seen here, is one of the key aspects of Ma Yuan's novels. In fact, it is fundamentally the only way, the main way in which he is being understood as a metafictionist. So what gaps do I address in terms of one of my primary aims, which was a reappraisal of the Chinese avant-garde? So number one, because I'm creating an author study, I demonstrate that there's a very nuanced evolution within the author's writing. Fundamentally, the author didn't just write metafiction. So even though he was famous for writing specific texts using specific devices, overwhelmingly, the author also had a very rich tradition of realist work that started right at the start of his career and went and goes right up to the present. So doing an author-based study exposes many of the fundamental flaws that you will find within literary criticism, which are usually when an author is somehow defined by what is often very limited sample sizes. So the vast majority of Ma Yuan's novels have not been analyzed. They have not been addressed in any meaningful way. So the first thing that I address is I try to look as much as I can at every single work that he has done to try and find broader, more nuanced patterns within the author's work. The main argument that I make in terms of Ma Yuan's contribution to the avant-garde and postmodernism is that I argue that Ma Yuan functioned as a post-socialist cognitive release valve. Now what do I mean by that? So I think one of the key aspects of understanding postmodernism in a Chinese context is to make sure that we understand it as not necessarily a form of global postmodernism, but rather a specific post-socialist form of postmodernism, whereby distinctly postmodernist aesthetics were clearly seen, and yet the cultural landscape was much more typified by a withdrawal of the organs of socialism rather than an arrival at a certain stage of capitalism as it was seen in the US and Europe, for example. Now, my argument is that within the avant-garde period, the withdrawal of restrictions on literary practice, the withdrawal of the aims and the preconditions for what literature was supposed to do, which namely were to serve some kind of instrumentalist function, be that through socialist realism or other forms of literary practice, as they were removed, there was a huge gap. There was a huge need for a rapid advance and a rapid broadening of the scale of what literature could do. Now, the best way to rapidly increase the breadth of literary, the scope of literature, was not to create works of realism as had been ordained through the sort of more controlled socialist realism era, but to write works of metafiction. In my opinion, metafiction was the most logical way of rapidly expanding the possibilities of literary practice. Now, why is that? It is much easier to write about the writing of something than it is to frame a holistic represented world. So for example, Ma Yuan wrote a huge range of different novels. Some of them were set in leper colonies. Some of them were based on the Himalayan mountains, involving mythologized narratives of hunting, for example. Now, within a realist frame, it would be quite difficult to adequately set that up in a way that had any kind of meaningful purchase. But if you write about the writing of those narratives, you can then create a rapid expansion of the possibility of narrative itself. Because an author, a represented author, can have a relationship with any kind of different text. It doesn't have to be ones that could realistically fall within their expected epistemological frameworks. So in my opinion, one of the main reasons why Ma Yuan used metafictional devices is because it rapidly expanded the range of narratives that he could cover. Because you can realistically present an author and his or her text, and that text can be anything. Whereas if you have a more covertly framed realist structure, there is often an expectation that these narratives somehow have to relate to the implied author. They have to relate back to a real human being's life and what they have experienced within their life. So how do you remove those restrictions? I think you write metafiction. So I think that's one of the perhaps under analyzed aspects of metafiction within the avant-garde. So I refer to Foucault's concept of the heterotopia, which is not a particularly easy concept to understand. The best simple explanation that I've seen of the heterotopia is by the scholar Robert Topinka, who suggested that heterotopias were literary or cultural spaces in which order is made legible. So I think this perfectly applies to Ma Yuan's metafictional writing. What he is doing fundamentally is rapidly expanding the possibilities of narrative, and he is making order, the ordering of narrative, the expectations of narrative, legible. He's exposing them and making them legible. So I include a lot of Foucault's work on heterotopias within my book as a way of understanding what I mean by a cognitive release valve in this sense. I also include a lot of theory by Brian McHale on postmodernism and possible worlds theory. But the thing that I focus on the most is the role of self-reflexivity and defamiliarization. In my opinion, the political, philosophical, and spiritual dynamics of self-reflexivity have been under-analyzed in terms of the Chinese avant-garde. So postmodernism, avant-gardism, metafiction, in my opinion, they were not merely a manifestation of formalist destabilization, but rather They functioned, as I was suggesting, as cognitive release valves, opening up Foucauldian heterotopias. Now, I would argue that a lot of critics understand postmodernism in this way, as formal experiments, ways of moving the boundaries of the generic expectations. But I don't think that argument holds up with Ma Yuan at all. The reason why is because there's very little evidence of parody within his writing. In contrast, for example, to Yuhua, who often had overt parodies of specific classic pre-modern or modern literary genres, Ma Yuan never does that. He never includes overt parody. I argue actually that the ultimate site for Ma Yuan's self-reflexivity is his own epistemological framework, which brings me on to the role of Tibet in Ma Yuan's literary career, and in specifically in terms of his development of a metafictional style. So before moving to Tibet in 1982, the author published essentially realist works that included some late modernist techniques, such as omission. This is commonly also known as Hemingway's iceberg theory, which essentially is stating that within a fundamentally realist structure, the narrative itself may not necessarily capture all of the story. So this is, I would argue, a sort of early stage of self-reflexivity, in which the author is alerted to, the reader is alerted to the fact that there's somehow a dichotomy between what is actually in a narrative and where a meaning is located underneath the narrative level. However, when there is an extremely convenient distinction within the author's work, in that the very first work that he publishes after moving to Tibet is one of his most metafictional. So I argue that when the author relocates to Tibet, there is a clear narrative tension that arises between different epistemological frameworks. So we have to also remember that writing about Tibet and writing about different ethnicities within China, certainly within the 1980s, was definitely a politically charged endeavor. It was something that had just come out of a very specific socialist realist tradition in which non-Han minorities were always intended to be represented as needing to be accommodated within the Han project of modernity, and to somehow be always offered material benefits through joining the Han project of modernity. So fundamentally, representations of Tibet were solidified within a very, very rigid framework by the time that Ma Yuan started writing Tibetan narratives. Now, Ma Yuan's Tibetan narratives fundamentally function in a completely different way. They do not fall into that strategy in any meaningful way. Firstly, the most important distinction is that the narrators within Ma Yuan's Tibetan novels are always aware of the fact that they are Han Chinese. They are always aware of the fact that they're linguistically and culturally different. They're always aware of the fact that their representations are not going to ever reach any kind of level of accuracy, because they are aware of a strong epistemological gap between the observer and the observed. So this tension, again, it inherently leads itself to a metafictional device, in that there is a clear tension, a fictionality between the observer and the observed. Also, within Ma Yuan's Tibet narratives, you often get explorers, travelers, hunters, itinerant people that are moving through the landscape, none of which can offer any kind of permanent or truth about that landscape. Also, whenever there are explorers or travelers within Ma Yuan's Tibet narratives, their expeditions will invariably fail. They'll often try to achieve a certain goal and they won't obtain it. The hunter's narratives are fabricated, they're unreliable, they're contradicted by other authors and narrators. And so there is never any one unified vision or perspective within this landscape. Also, even though Tibet itself is othered within this structure, there are other layers of even further othered others within this landscape. For example, Ma Yuan often includes narratives involving the Lhopa or Kampa minority peoples. And so you get a situation in which you have a Han Chinese author who is overtly declares the limitations of his own perspective, is in dialogue with figures who are othered within an already othered landscape. Now, within this situation, within this setup, within this metafictional device, it is impossible to locate any one didactic vision of this landscape. And that, more than anything, I think is the most key aspect of his Tibet narratives. One other thing to mention about the role of metafiction: not only is it a way of acting as a release valve, not only is it a way as a way of navigating the tension between epistemological frameworks, in a sense, metafiction worked very well as a way to circumvent not necessarily censorship, but certainly areas of political sensitivity. So have a look at this quote, for example. This comes at the end of a passage in which an author figure is declaring how much he admires Tibet, and he is overtly criticizing Han Chinese ideas about modernity. So he goes on to say, "We believe that we are intelligent," by which he means Han China, "and civilized, and that they," by which he means Tibetans, "are simple and primitive, and that they need us to save and enlighten them." Now, after this happens, another author figure makes this incursion here. "Please excuse this fallacious argument. Author's note. Further author's note. These kinds of emotive monologues in novels are very irritating, but as it has already happened, this author is not willing to take it back. It won't happen again." So this is a wonderful sleight of hand, because Ma Yuan had just presented a arguably very politically sensitive narrative, which overtly suggests that Han Chinese perceptions of Tibet are fundamentally flawed. And yet he allows this to exist by apologizing for it, but then saying, "It's already happened, I'm not going to remove it." So this, I think, is another perhaps under-analyzed role of metafiction within this particular context. So similar, I guess, to the Menglong poetry, the misty poetry, an element of obscurity and self sort of obfuscation can actually allow further possibility, and it can circumvent certain political sensitivities. So after arguing that there are specific ways of reappraising the avant-garde in terms of the author's output during the 1980s and within the avant-garde period, you then see that the author then starts to, after he leaves Tibet, there is a distinct shift in his narratives. Now, the author actually finishes writing in 1991, and for 20 years, he didn't write any more works of fiction. So for 20 years, it was assumed that Ma Yuan had essentially withdrawn from his literary career. At the end of this particular period, after leaving Tibet, there's a distinct paranoia that enters his works. Now, I argue that this is a direct reflection on the increasing wider social tensions within China towards the end of the 1980s. This is an interesting quote from one of his final novels. "My biggest concern is the fear of being misunderstood by you, by other people who are listening to me narrate." So Ma Yuan states that within this period, there were various different critics that started to write incredibly critical articles about him, to the extent that he actually became quite fearful of his livelihood. He became fearful about meeting political issues or censorship. So you see a distinct period towards the end of his initial literary output in which there's a real increase in paranoid and violent narratives. So by the time the author writes what was assumed to be his final work of fiction in 1991, he then essentially leaves literary practice. He works in TV, in film, in real estate, and then works as a lecturer in Shanghai. So it appeared then that Ma Yuan had essentially stopped writing and had consigned himself to a historical period. And this furthered the argument that essentially Ma Yuan's role was restricted to purely the avant-garde period, and that his formal experiments served their function, and that long-term they couldn't be sustained. Now, all of that changed in 2007 when the author was diagnosed with a serious lung condition. Now, rather than go into medical treatment, as was suggested, rather than undergo chemotherapy, the author decided to completely withdraw from modern life. He quit his job as a lecturer in Shanghai, and then moved to Nanluosan in southern Yunnan province. So this is where the author lives to this day. And these photographs I actually was able to take myself because I had the immense privilege of being able to visit him and stay with him for 4 days to interview him for this book. So since being diagnosed with this serious lung condition, the author has decided that the best way to live was to not try to attack his illness, but to live harmoniously with it. And in doing so, in withdrawing from modern life, he attempted, and is still in very good health to this day, to find the most pure, harmonious landscape with pure drinking water. He grows his own vegetables, makes his own tea, and has decided to essentially live in symbiosis with his illness, to the extent which he even told me that he actually talks to his illness every day. Now, as an aside, he also smokes like a chimney, but that's not important. But this has essentially started the second wave of his career. So since withdrawing from modern life, he has now returned to writing fiction again. So this then is the second part of my book, which is how do we assess this second wave of the author's career, considering that clearly he's no longer writing within the 1980s avant-garde period. He's clearly no longer writing in a postmodern context. He's writing in a completely different cultural context with a different identity as well. Now, in terms of his recent output, it's a fascinating combination of works of extreme metafiction, works of realism, such as Zhoutan, this one here, and also works of nonfiction, Tao Li, which is an autobiographical work, which essentially describes his decision to leave Shanghai and to live this harmonious lifestyle in a natural ecosystem. Now, the first novel that he wrote in 2012 was Niuguisosan, which is a work of extreme, it's an extremely metafictional work. It functions essentially like a metafictional memoir in which he reconceptualizes his old works and pieces them together to create some kind of elaborate diary of his life. So there are huge chunks of his previously published novels that are essentially reappraised and recontextualized and restructured within this new novel. It is absurdly intertextual, by which I mean it references, directly quotes, and recontextualizes a vast array of different works, both by Ma Yuan himself and other authors. It also includes diary entries and also what appear to be lecture notes as well, in which the author gives his opinions on philosophy and on life. And in particular, he talks about his new identity as a bingren, as a patient. Now, this is really important because now that Ma Yuan has decided that he is writing as a patient, as a person who is living with a disease. He has now, I argue, developed a distinct eco-consciousness. Within Niuhui Susan, there's a very strong pessimism regarding the path of China's economic development. And there's a very strong philosophical argument that China is fundamentally on a disastrous path towards ecological catastrophe. Now, this isn't just seen presented as an economic issue. It's presented as a philosophical one. This is perhaps one of the most interesting quotes from this novel. Many people may think that the most important issue they face is the issue of the self, but actually the primary issue people face is not to do with the self, but the other, or with you. It is only when the other is present that there will be any issues. The strange thing is that people cannot see themselves. Ma Yuan cannot see Ma Yuan. To do so, you have to go find a mirror or look at your reflection in water. Only then is it possible. Now, within this second wave of his career, the author is fundamentally using metafiction in a different way. I argue that no longer is it necessary to create these post-socialist cognitive release valves. What the author is doing is that he is showing the fundamental limitations of contemporary conceptions of modernity. And specifically, this involves a distinct eco-consciousness and aware of the limitations of the Anthropocene. Similarly, in another extremely self-reflexive novel, Guniangzai, that he wrote subsequently, the author explores the lost mythologies of the Nanluoshan mountain where he is currently residing. The most interesting aspect of this novel is that he includes various different elements of shamanism and dialogues with ancestor figures. Now, even though this novel was written 2 years before the COVID pandemic, one of the central narratives within this novel is a mass pandemic, which almost wipes out the entire population, Nanluoshan. The reason why this pandemic happens, according to this novel, is that there's a fundamental imbalance in the equilibrium between people, the current residents of Nanluoshan, and the ancestors. So because the tradition of shamanism and tradition of mythology has been lost by science and logic, there is then a rupture within the continuum between the ancestors and the present day. And that causes a mass pandemic. So I think this is a fascinatingly prescient novel, again, written 2 years before COVID, of the fragile equilibrium that is under the surface of contemporary modernity. And then finally, not only is Ma Yuan again writing metafiction in a completely different context, he's also again writing works of realism. Now, these new works of realism are diametrically completely different to works such as Niuhui Susan, the works of high metafiction. They are extremely sparse and they don't involve any meaningful authorial guidance. Instead, they describe the logic of contemporary society using its own logic. For example, Zhoutan is the narrative of the absurd legal and bureaucratic complications resulting from the central protagonists inheriting their father's estate. Now, the father wishes to donate all his wealth in the spirit of Leifeng, but in doing so, the central protagonists get embroiled in this absurd bureaucratic nightmare in which they ultimately get, because of a slight irregularity in the way that the inheritance was set up, it then threatens to undermine all of the entire process. So fundamentally, Zhoutan is a novel that describes the absurd complications and the gap between the moral imperative to emulate the spirit of Leifeng and the legal and bureaucratic nature of contemporary society. Similarly, Huang Tang Yijia, another incredibly similar work of realism, revolving around a wealthy family involved in local business and local government. Fundamentally, it presents a wealthy family that are in constant state of peril, of losing everything. whether this be because of the husband of the family is a local government official who was constantly paranoid about being undermined by his colleagues or having the wrong kind of content about him posted on Weibo or something like that. So the structures that they have created through their wealth are incredibly fragile, and they're completely paranoid about them collapsing. Both of these novels have the same point of transition, in which the central protagonist suffers a sudden illness. So again, we are seeing Ma Yuan's role as the bingren, the patient. Given that he has gone through this life-changing event, he sees how the illness has changed his epistemological framework. And according to these novels, Ma Yuan is suggesting that fundamentally contemporary Chinese society cannot see its own disease. It does not know where its disease is located. And as such, there are recurring motifs of collapse and unsustainability. Now, even though that is the case, the characters within these realist novels are still highly intelligent, highly analytical, and they are able to make very concise political statements. So for example, here, the central characters are stating how government advocations of particular government policies are essentially hollow, and that they are masking lacks in society rather than actually providing anything substantial. So even though this novel presents the idea that successful, wealthy, intelligent people can understand their lives on a conceptual level, it also says that they cannot see themselves. They do not see where their own illness lies. Which then leads me to my final conclusion, which is, what is the current Chinese post-postmodern condition? In my opinion, the most significant aspect of the Chinese post-postmodern condition is the role of eco-consciousness and the Anthropocene within current Chinese political literary practice. So the conclusions that I make about Mayan's post-postmodernism is that there is a distinct eco-consciousness and patient subjectivity, which anticipates ecological catastrophe and the unsustainability of the Anthropocene. Okay, excellent, great. Thank you very much, everyone. I tried to speed up at the end because I did realize that we're going a little bit over time. So thank you very much.